Good afternoon, and welcome to the Catholic Community of St. Brennan. Today is the vigil of the 26th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our celebrant is our pastor, Father Tim, and the special intention of this Mass is for Mary Blonde. We extend a warm welcome to our parishioners and visitors this weekend as we celebrate the 26th Sunday in Ordinary Time. We ask that you kindly do not remove your mask when you come for communion and consume the host at the side of the celebrant or Eucharistic minister. If you have inadvertently forgotten your mask, please ask an usher for one. Now please, for the benefit of everyone, we ask that you turn off your cell phone or other electronic device. Please stand now as we begin our celebration. Thank you.
O God, who manifest your almighty power, above all by pardoning and showing mercy, bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hastening to attain your promises heirs to the treasures of heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, you say, the Lord's way is not fair. Hear now, house of Israel, is it my way that is unfair? Or rather, are not your ways unfair? When someone virtuous turns away from virtue to commit iniquity and dies, it is because of the iniquity he committed he must die. But if he turns from wickedness he has committed and does what is right and just, he shall preserve his life, since he has turned away from all sins that he has committed. He has surely lived. He shall not die. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any solace in love, any participation in the Spirit, any compassion and mercy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, with the same love, united in heart, thinking one thing. Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vainglory. Rather, humbly regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interest, but also for those of others. Have in you the same attitude that is also in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness and found human in appearance, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and elders of the people, "What is your opinion? A man had two sons. He came to the first and said, 'Son, go out and work in the vineyard today.' He said in reply, 'I will not,' but afterwards changed his mind and went. The man came to the other son and gave the same order. He said in reply, 'Yes, sir,' but did not go. Which of the two did the father's will?" They answered, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Amen, I say to you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you. When John came to you in the way of righteousness, you did not believe him, but tax collectors and prostitutes did. And even when you saw that, you did not later change your minds and believe him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So I was thinking about something from my childhood. Again, I've been talking a lot about my childhood lately. But have you ever heard of, some of you probably have, about party lines, you know, the phones, party lines, you know? Believe it or not, when I was a kid, we still had party lines. Now, we didn't have it in our little town. We had regular private lines in our little town. I lived in a little town of 400 people, but we had private lines. But out in the farming community around us, the farms, a lot of the farms, still had the party lines. And my friend Brian, my best friend Brian, he had to share a line with two other farms. So it was three families that had to share a phone. And whenever I went out to his house, you know, I'd go out there for a weekend. It was always fun because, especially with the phone, because, you know, if you don't know this, in order to know if someone is going to call you, you have to know, you know, the particular ring. So they had like a couple of short rings and a long ring, and they would know it was their ring. But you would also hear the ring of the other two farms if they were being called. So you heard all of it. And then you also heard, you know, if you accidentally picked up the phone, well, maybe not so accidentally, you could pick up the phone if they were on the line. It was like the phone being in your own house. You could hear the conversation from the other farms. Well, the farm on the south side of him was one of our classmates. Her name was Karen. And she was always on the phone. So if we had nothing better to do, we would sometimes pick up the phone. And sure enough, she would be on the phone. She would be talking to some of our other classmates, some of the other girls. They would always be
talking about the boys and gossiping about things, you know. Or sometimes if there was a call to that house, because we wouldn't know what the ring was to that house, sometimes we'd pick it up because often it was for Karen. And so Brian said, "You want to do it?" And I said, "Yeah, let's do it." And so we'd pick up the phone and we'd listen real carefully. And she'd be talking. And sometimes we couldn't hold, you know, our laughter. And so we would giggle and she would hear us. And she'd say, "Brian, get off the phone. Can't anybody have any privacy around here?" And Brian would say, "No." And that was true, because we couldn't have any privacy in that community. Everybody knew everybody's business. There was no privacy. There was no secrets. You know, and I was thinking about that, especially with our gospel this evening, because there was no privacy in Jesus' day. Well, anyway, little privacy. There was little secrets, very, very little bit of that, because everybody knew everybody's business. And so honor was very important. You know, it still is today. Honor is a core value in Middle Eastern culture because, you know, everybody knows each other. There's no secrets. So honor and shame is very important. And so honor is the public claim of one's worth and then the public's confirmation or acknowledgement of that worth. And so in this gospel that we're hearing, Jesus is being challenged of that honor. They're challenging his honor because right before this gospel, we hear in the passage right before this, he's teaching in the temple. And the chief priests and the elders, they're saying, "Where are you getting this authority? What authority do you have to do this?" They're challenging his honor, and they're doing it publicly. And Jesus tells this parable. First, he asks them a question about John the Baptist. They won't answer it. But then he tells this parable. And he shares this parable about the Father giving a public claim of his own honor by telling his sons to go out and work in the vineyard. One says he won't do it. Publicly, he says he won't do it, but then later does. The other one says publicly, "Yes, I will do it, Father," but he doesn't do it. You know the irony of this? Is that the one who says he will do it, but doesn't, is the one who shows honor to the Father. The one who says he doesn't, he won't do it, but later does do it, and so the damage has already been done. The people are not going to later check on him to see if he did it or not. He already did the damage. But the question that Jesus asks, this is the thing. Jesus didn't ask which of the two sons honored the Father. The question that Jesus asked was, which of the two did the will of the Father? Because this is the thing that Jesus is saying to the chief priests and the elders. My honor, my respect and my worth is not based on what you say, what you see, what you do. My honor and my worthiness is based only on what God says and what God sees, God the Father. How often is our motivation based on what other people see, what other people say, rather than what God sees and what God says? You know, I was reading a story a while back from Reader's Digest. You know, there's a section in Reader's Digest, it's called True Stories. So there's only two or three real brief stories people write in telling things that happen to themselves, true stories. And one man wrote about a time when he was cutting his lawn. He was on his riding lawnmower, and you know, it looks like a a little tractor. And there were two nuns, he was surprised, there was two nuns in full habit watching him. I think it was in Indiana, so there's a monastery close by. And so he rides up close to them, and the two nuns said, you know, they've always admired watching him cut his grass. I guess he had a big lawn. And one of them, one of the sisters said that she always wanted to drive a tractor. I guess the riding lawnmower looked like a miniature tractor. And he said, well, sure, sister, I'll let you drive the riding lawnmower. So he put up the blades and put the speed on the lowest setting and allowed the sister to get on and drive it. So she was driving on, and he was standing there with the other sister, and he said to the other sister, you know, it's just like driving a car. And the sister said, well, sister's never driven a car before. And he looked at her, and she was driving straight towards a fire hydrant. So he started running after her, and he says, turn it, turn it. And the other sister says, she can't hear either. See, it doesn't matter what other people hear, what other people say or do, what they think about us. Really, ultimately, that shouldn't be our motivation. Our ultimate motivation should be what God thinks, what God sees. That should be our ultimate motivation. That's where our ultimate worth, our ultimate dignity comes from. And that's what Jesus is telling us in today's gospel. My sheep know me, Jesus says. They hear my voice, and they follow me.
God guides the humble to justice and teaches them the way. And so in humility, we bring our needs before God.
For our Jewish brothers and sisters, as they observe Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the holiest day of the year, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are seeking the Lord in today's complicated world, that they may see the face of Christ reflected in the goodness and mercy of those who serve others in need, we pray to the Lord. For the intention of this Mass, for the happy repose of the soul of Mary Galante, we pray to the Lord. For all that are sick, especially Anthony Robert Volpe and Edward Vera, that they may find the healing comfort of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
For
all who have died, especially all who have lost their lives during that recent national natural disasters, that they may rejoice at the eternal banquet. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions, both spoken and unspoken. We pray to the Lord.
Merciful God, remember your compassion as we struggle to do your will. Listen to the prayers that we make here today, and in your kindness and goodness, answer them through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Grant us, O merciful God, that this, our offering, may find acceptance with you, and that through it, the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
Amen.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin. Fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. So the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory, as with one voice we acclaim. Disciples saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Gregory our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of resurrection. In a special way, they remember Mary Galante in this Mass, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. And have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, St. Brendan, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, that we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
In the kingdom, the power, and the glory
of the Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant the peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And
let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Thank you.
God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to be taken under your
Thank you.
Let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ, to whose suffering we are united whenever we proclaim his death, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Just a reminder again, please leave your offering in the basket before you go, and thank you for your generosity and support to our parish. And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Have a great week, everyone.
You too.